Greetings, and once again, it's really a joy. It's truly a joy to be here this morning. I really thank you, the pastors, for their kind invitation. And as Pastor Lynette has wished earlier, I'd like to repeat and wish all you mothers, great-grandmothers, great-grandmothers, mothers-to-be, godmothers, and the list goes on, a very blessed Mother's Day. And, you know, every time I share at Mother's Day, it's always honor your mother, until I decided that this round I'm going to do something different. Sorry, I have this... Do you all hear the echo? Can you just... Okay, as long as you don't hear it, it's fine. And this morning, as a tribute to mothers and frankly to women in general, I'm going to do something different. I'm going to share about two very special women, one of whom is found in today's scripture reading. But before I begin, let's, as usual, go to the Lord in prayer. Shall we pray? Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for your word, a word that is ever alive and sharper than any two-edged sword. And we pray, Lord, that your word will always be our rule, your Holy Spirit our teacher, and your glory our concern. So open our ears and speak to us right now, Lord, for we, your people, are listening. Amen. The year was 1907. Single and single-minded, Jesse Brand decided to go to India as a medical missionary. He journeyed there alone, but he was not alone for too long, because back home in England, a girl by the name of Evelyn Harris, who was the undisputed babe of the upscale London crowd, chose to abandon her glamorous life, travel to India, and marry Jesse. Well, the couple lived in the Chart Mountains, and their flea-covered rats swarmed through the village, spreading disease. But Jesse and Evelyn gave medical aid to the villagers, and they organized programs to help the local farmers make a better living. They talked about Jesus to everyone they met. In 1 year alone, Jesse preached 4,000 times in 90 villages. As new believers popped up, the Brand started new churches to train believers in the scriptures. When their son Paul was born, Jesse and Evelyn were determined to raise him up with a love for God, for nature, and for India. And Evelyn would take her son in the shade, would teach her son in the shade of a tamarind tree. And Jesse often took Paul on long nature walks, teaching him to see God in the wonders around him. And at age 9, Paul was sent to England to be educated. Over the years, the Brands continued providing medical aid to the Indian villages. But in 1928, Jesse developed blackwater fever. Yet he managed to preach even with a 104-degree temperature. But 2 days later, Jesse's temperature reached 106 degrees, and Evelyn sat by his bedside and watched her husband slowly die. She had worked by his side for 15 years, and now she planned to carry on that work alone. Meanwhile, word of the father's death reached Paul, and within a day or two, a letter from his father arrived from India, and in it, Jesse wrote, "And always looking to God with thankfulness and worship for having placed you in such a delightful corner of the universe as the planet Earth." Years later, legends tell of an old woman the villagers called Granny Brand, who could be seen hiking over the mountains with her walking stick. She lived to see her son, Dr. Paul Brand, become a famous missionary doctor, specializing in the treatment of leprosy. Friends, the Brands are people who seek to make a difference. And they're known for doing crazy things, doing good deeds for no reward, putting other people before themselves and talking about a man who lived 2,000 years ago. And yes, such a lifestyle raises quite a few questions, and usually eyebrows too. What's the motivation? People wonder, there's got to be a catch. You know, nobody does things just because. But that is exactly what makes Christianity stand apart from the other religions of the world. Because becoming a Christian is a commitment to change. It is a decision to become the kind of person that the Bible talks about, that the Bible prescribes that Christians should be. To do the things that Jesus spoke about in the Sermon on the Mount, of what it is to be a Christian. And for that, let's look at Beatitudes found in Matthew 5, 3 to 12. God blesses those people who depend only on Him. They belong to the kingdom of heaven. God blesses those people who grieve. They will find comfort. God blesses those people who are humble. The earth will belong to them. God blesses those people who want to obey Him more than to eat or drink. They will be given what they want. God blesses those people who are merciful. They will be treated with mercy. God blesses those people whose hearts are pure. They will see Him. God blesses those people who make peace. They will be called His children. God blesses those people who are treated badly for doing right. They belong to the kingdom of heaven. God will bless you when people insult you, mistreat you, and tell all kinds of evil lies about you because of me. Be happy and excited. You will have a great reward in heaven. People did these same things to the prophets who lived long ago. But sadly, the world has such a shortage of these type of people. You know, Soren Kierkegaard, he once said, "If you mean by Christian what the Sermon on the Mount says about being a Christian, then in any given time in history, there may be only 4 or 5 such persons who have the right to call themselves Christians." Friends, we need people who are prepared to do radical things for Christ. People who want to make a difference, especially the God kind of difference. And many times we discount ourselves and what we can do because we think we're too small. We think we're too powerless to make a difference. And friends, if that is the case, perhaps we then can take a lesson from today's servant girl found in today's scripture. The Bible records only one statement this girl made. And a part in the Bible is so small that the scripture writer doesn't even mention her name. But let's now turn to the passage in 2 Kings 5, verses 1 to 3, and hear the word of God. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Syria. He was a great and honorable man in the eyes of his master because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was also a mighty man of valor, but a leper. And the Syrians had gone on raids and had brought back captive a young girl from the land of Israel. She waited on Naaman's wife. Then she said to her mistress, "If only my master were with the prophet who is in Samaria, for he would heal him of his leprosy." This little girl was a mere slave owned by Naaman, who was a powerful and highly respected man. And not only was Naaman an outstanding general, the commander of the Syrian army, but he was also a trusted companion of the king and also a great warrior. In fact, if there had been a who's who list in Syria, his name would have been at the top of the list. But there was a stain on Naaman's resume. He was a leper. And for him to have achieved and maintained his position as a military commander, despite that affliction, Naaman must have possessed amazing, unmatched skills. And yet, in the face of such position and power, this little servant girl chose to act. You know, she could have remained silent and safely anonymous. But instead, she took the courage to speak to Naaman's wife. And this really, really was a remarkable act. For she chose to act and to take the risk of what could happen to her if she was wrong in a prediction. And from the actions of this servant girl, we can learn three things. Number one, the servant girl acted even though she was small. You know, many times we discount what we can do because we think we're too small or too powerless to make a difference. But consider this girl's situation. She was a slave, and that was the lowest anyone could be in a social standing. She was an outsider. She was a Jew living in Syria. She was young. Why would a powerful leader even listen to her? And she was female. Female in a very male-dominated culture. And so, by the standards of that day, she had nothing going for her. No power, no position, no possessions. The only thing she had was her faith. But that was enough. As God told the Apostle Paul centuries later, "My grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness." And friends, that's it. That's the most exciting thing about God. That He is always with us. And that with God, all things are possible. There's nothing too hard for Him. He has far more power than is necessary to meet our needs and enable us to do the things that we cannot do. And yes, God can use anyone. On our part, we only need to be willing, we only need to be ready. And right now I can hear some of you maybe even saying, "But you see, I don't have any talents to use for the Lord. I have nothing to offer." You know, when spiritual gifts were being given, I was standing at the end of the line. But friends, if ever there was a person who could have offered Jesus an excuse, Robert Reed would have been that person. Because you see, Robert Reed's hands, they are twisted and his feet are useless. He can't bathe himself, he can't feed himself, he can't brush his teeth, comb his hair, or even put on his underwear. His shirts are held together by strips of Velcro. His speech drags like a worn-out audio cassette because Robert Reed has cerebral palsy. The disease kept him from driving a car. He couldn't ride a bike. He couldn't even go for a walk. But it did not keep him from graduating from high school or attending Abilene Christian University, from which he graduated with a degree in Latin. Having cerebral palsy didn't keep him from teaching at a St. Louis Junior College or from venturing overseas on his mission, 5 mission trips. And Robert's disease didn't keep him from becoming a missionary to Portugal. In 1927, he moved to Lisbon alone. There, he rented a hotel room and began studying Portuguese. He found a restaurant owner who would feed him after the rush hours and a tutor who instructed him in the language. And then daily, he would station himself in the park where he distributed brochures about Christ. And within 6 years, Robert Reed led 70 people to Christ. Robert Reed did not see fit to offer excuses to the Lord because of his condition. And so, friends, let me ask you this morning, what is your excuse? Which brings me to point two. The servant girl acted even though what she could do was small. You see, as a member of the king's court, Naaman had access to the best physicians in the country. Everyone in the household undoubtedly watched as he tried every available treatment for his leprosy, and nothing worked. And in the midst of all this activity, what the servant girl could do must have really seemed rather small. After all, she couldn't heal Naaman. She couldn't ease his pain. All she could do was to make a suggestion to her mistress. And yet we find that she didn't let the seemingly insignificance of that act stop her. Instead of being discouraged by what she could not do, she did what she could do. In the same way, friends, don't be afraid of doing something even though it seems insignificant, even though it may seem small. Because only God knows how great an impact a small act can do. And don't think that your small act of kindness does not matter. You'd be surprised at what significance it can make. Let me tell you a true story that occurred in World War II. An Allied bomber had crossed the English Channel. It had made its way to the German, past the German guns, and they dropped its load on Berlin. As it started its return flight back to England, a group of German fighters appeared on the horizon, and one German fighter managed to get the bomber within its range. And the crew of the bomber watched helplessly as bullets began spitting from the German plane. They stared in horror as five bullets, one after another, pierced the body of the bomber and penetrated the fuselage where the gas tanks were located. The crew of the bomber, they waited. They waited for an explosion or a fire to break out. But nothing happened. Not one spark or puff of smoke appeared. All they heard was the methodical dripping of gas from the tank. Well, the bomber managed to land safely in its English airfield, and the crew climbed down to inspect the aircraft and carefully removed the shell of the fuselage. Inside it, they found five nearly perfect bullets. The bullets hadn't exploded. They had just crumpled, and the crew took the bullets back to their barracks for inspection. When the soldiers opened four of the bullets, they found something amazing. There was no gunpowder inside. The bullets were completely empty. But when they opened the fifth bullet, they found something extraordinary. Rolled into a tiny wad inside the bullet was a note that read, "We are Polish POWs, forced to make bullets in factory. When guards do not look, we do not fill with powder. It's not much, but it's best we can do. Please tell family we are alive. Signed, four Polish prisoners of war." Friends, how many times have you been led to believe that what you do for Christ isn't much? How many times have you wondered whether your small efforts, your prayers, your acts of kindness make any difference at all? Then let me tell you this morning. Don't be misled. Every act is as significant as one of those bullets. Just as one small gesture by four Polish prisoners saved the life of the crew on the bomber, so one small act of kindness on your part can have a huge impact on someone else's life. An act of kindness, no matter how small, can go a long way to make a difference. And in fact, there are many acts of kindness that you can do, regardless of your strengths, your training, your church tenure. And let me suggest some ways you can get involved. First, reach people for Christ. Help out in the evangelistic ministry of your church, or go on a short mission trip, or spread the good news to other countries. Next, you can also speak to people's needs. Serve the abused, the homeless, and the needy in your church or community. Reach out to those in need. You know, your task may be as mundane or small as delivering food, or maybe as personal as praying with someone who is discouraged. Remember, friends, it all counts with God. And God sees the time, the effort, and the love that you put in it. And He sees the person with a broken heart who caught that glimmer of hope because you prayed for them. Or you can give your money to God, tithe, support your ministries, give to organizations that work on His behalf. Because whenever we give, we help to keep God's work afloat, and He will bless you more than you expect. Now, the blessing may not come in material or financial ways, but you can be sure that it will come. Because God takes delight in joyful givers. Our world operates in a, what's in it for me? But by contrast, our thought should be, what is in it for God? Finally, do something you don't want to. Pick up somebody else's trash. Surrender your favorite seat. Call a long-winded relative, or carry the chairs after a church meeting, or clean up after an event. You see, your acts don't have to be a big thing. Helen Keller once told the Tennessee legislature that when she was young, she wanted to do big things. She wanted to do great things. But when she found that she could not, she decided to do small things, but in a great way. Small things, but in a great way. So don't be too big to do something small. 1 Corinthians 15:58 tells us, throw yourselves into the work of the Master, confident that nothing you do for Him is a waste of time or effort. Third point, the servant girl acted even though the stakes were not small. You know, she took a big risk. She took a huge risk when she expressed her faith that God could heal Naaman. If he had gone to Israel to be healed and came back still sick and looking foolish, he would no doubt have punished the servant girl. In fact, when Naaman received permission from the king to leave Syria for Samaria, the stakes went up not only for the girl, but also for the entire nation of Israel. When Israel kings received Naaman and found out he expected to be healed, the king lost hope and he tore his clothes in grief. He believed that the Syrian king was just finding an excuse to wage war on him. But then we know that the prophet Elisha heard that Naaman had come, and Elisha told the general what to do. And when Naaman obeyed Elisha's instructions to bathe in the Jordan River 7 times, the Syrian commander was healed. And the Bible tells us that Naaman's skin was restored that day. It became like that of a child. More importantly, his faith was changed. And in that moment, he realized that God was God, and he sought to worship Him the rest of his life. Like the servant girl, we need to be confident. The servant girl's mistress listened to her. Why? Because she believed in what she told her. She had faith in God. And the same way, friends, we have a great God. There's nothing He can't do. So we need to live like we believe it. If God can use this servant girl, God can use you. Because in God's kingdom, it is the insignificant that takes center stage. It is where the weak are made strong, where the humble are lifted up, and obedience to God in the little details often demonstrate big faith. You know, God can use anyone, and God can use you as long as you are willing. And the time has come, really, for a whole new generation to come along, a generation who does not live for themselves, a generation who wants to do something for others, a generation who wants to do something heroic with their lives. And that generation, friends, is you. I'm asking you to let Jesus change the world, to use you to change the world, to make a difference. And you probably heard this line 1,000 times. And most of you may even have heard it growing up. But you haven't done anything about it. If so, perhaps this final story I'm going to tell, another true story, will change your mind. A preacher was leaving Victoria Station in London. And sitting across him in the little train compartments were 2 men in their late 30s. About 10 minutes out of the station, one of the men had an epileptic fit. His eyes rolled back, his body trembled, and the man rolled off the seat onto the floor and shook uncontrollably. Those who have seen epileptic fits will know what I mean. It was a shocking thing to see. But his friend lifted the stricken man up and put him back onto the seat. He took off his overcoat and put it around him as a blanket. He rolled up a newspaper and put it into his mouth, lest he bite his tongue. Then with great compassion, he lovingly blotted the beads of perspiration on the epileptic man's forehead. Well, after a few minutes, the seizure ended just as abruptly as it had begun, and the stricken man dropped into a deep sleep. It was then that the friend turned to the preacher and said, "You have to forgive us. He doesn't have these seizures very often, but we never know when they are going to come. You see, we were in Vietnam together. We were both wounded. I lost a leg," and pointing to his right leg, he said, "This is an artificial leg, but I've learned to walk on it pretty well. My friend here had half of his chest blown away by a hand grenade. There was shrapnel all through his chest, and every time he moved, he experienced great pain. The helicopter that was supposed to rescue us was blown out of the sky by an enemy rocket. And with that explosion, we knew that all hope for rescue was gone." It was then that my friend picked himself up. He screamed in pain with every move he made, but somehow he stood to his feet. And then he reached down and he grabbed hold of my shirt and started pulling me through the jungle. I tried to tell him to give up on me. I pleaded with him, "Save yourself." I kept telling him there was no way he was going to get us both out of the jungle, and I'll never forget his words. "Jack, if you die in this jungle, I'm going to die here with you." I don't know how he did it. By step, scream by scream, he pulled me out of this mess and he saved my life. Well, a year ago, I found that he had this condition and that somebody had to be with him all the time. So I closed down my condo, I sold my car, and I came over to take care of him. That's our story. I hope you understand. The preacher responded by saying, don't apologize. I'm a preacher. Whenever I come upon a good story, I'm thrilled. And this is one of the best stories I've heard in a long time." His new friend on the other compartment said, "Hey, don't be impressed. You see, after what he did for me, there isn't anything I wouldn't do for him. After what he did for me, there isn't anything I wouldn't do for him." The Christian is someone who recognizes what Jesus did on the cross to accomplish salvation, and who in response says to Jesus, "Lord, after what you did for me, there isn't anything I wouldn't do for you." And friends, Jesus is here right now. And he's saying to you, "Give me your life. Join my army. Participate in my great movement in history. For my sake, in response to what I have done for you, give me your life to do my will." So what are you waiting for? To all of you sitting out there and online, I say this, carpe diem. Seize the day, because friends, a life of serving God is truly a life that is well lived. And if you have been sitting on the sidelines waiting for the perfect time to jump in the game, don't wait anymore. The time is now. Take risks and dare to make a difference. Dare to make a difference for God, and God will show you how. God will show you what to do and where to go. And when you can honestly say, "Lord, change the world through me. Help me make a difference. I'm ready to go anywhere and I'm ready to do anything," then friends, the revolution is about to explode. Let us pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we ask that you give us your understanding, that no one and no task is too small to make a difference for you and for them. And so, Lord, even right now, we ask that you give us the courage to say and do the little things that can impact others' lives, that, so that, Lord, through us, we can make a difference for you and for the world. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you.